Hey everybody, my name is Don Sheehy. I'm a professor at the, I was gonna say the University of Connecticut. I'm not a professor at the University of Connecticut. I used to be for several years. Now I'm a professor at North Carolina State University. This course is graph theory. So it's being taught at the graduate level, but we've got undergraduates too. And I think hopefully if these videos are shared more widely, then we'll have all kinds of users for this course. Students in this course of all kinds. It's currently, as I'm recording this, this is 2020. And the goal is to put together lecture videos for a kind of flipped class. All right, so there is, let's see, three different course numbers for this course, at least currently. It's Computer Science 565, it's Math 565, and it's also Operations Research 565. So the audience is kind of broad. Personally, I am a computer scientist. I do theoretical computer science. So my work is heavily mathematical. The course is essentially going to be a math course on the math of graph theory. It has a lot of applications to computer science, and we'll see a couple of them. But for the most part, we're going to learn the math. Now, because the audience is broad, this is sort of an okay thing because graph theory as a field is incredibly broad. You could look at textbooks and get a feel like, oh, like there's like a canonical set of things that you learn to learn graph theory. But then you realize if you look at a couple more books that there are just many, many more books and many more topics and many subfields of graph theory that you could cover. So whenever you get to teach a graph theory course, if you ever get to be so lucky, you're always in this situation where you're picking and choosing what topics to cover. And so the plan with this particular course is to try to get a feel for different subfields of graph theory. Now, what that means for us practically is that we're going to take what it starts out as like the main first thing you see in graph theory, which would be the kind of combinatorial perspective. And combinatorics refers to the study of objects built from finite sets, finite or discrete sets, and the kinds of ways they can come together. So when you combine things into a set, you can ask questions about, you know, how many different kinds of arrangements you have. And so those enumerative questions are enumerative combinatorics. We're not going to get into so many of those. But the starting point for most graph theory is combinatorial. It's thinking about the graph as a system of sets, that is, these things called vertices and these things called edges, which we'll talk about. But I'm going to expect that probably you've seen graphs and now you really want to learn them more deeply. So that first combinatorial perspective covers what would usually be considered kind of the canon of graph theory. But we can pretty soon after you start working with graphs, maybe even before you start working with them formally, you draw them. And thinking about drawings of graphs naturally leads you to think of them from a topological perspective. And so we're going to look at how you can take a graph as a combinatorial object and turn it into a set of points in, say, the plane or a set of points in 3D, and how to do that in a mathematically rigorous way so you can learn things about the combinatorial structure from the topological structure, and vice versa a little bit. Now, once you start talking about things in 2D and 3D, it's natural to think of them not just as sets, but as having some other structure, like having, say, straight edges. And that's where you get into the geometric perspective. And doing geometry, actually, modern geometry is mostly done by linear algebra. This is in some ways a shame if you're like me and you sort of love classic geometry. But a lot of times, in fact, probably in your high school geometry class, you spent most of the time doing basic algebra, especially linear algebra. And for graphs, a similar thing is going to happen where we're going to do, I'm going to put linear here, although we might not just limit ourselves to linear algebra. So all kinds of algebraic methods, I better make this an adjective so it fits in to this form. linear algebraic methods are going to be very useful for us for understanding and reasoning and working with graphs. It's very natural to take a graph and extract out some vector spaces and learn some properties of the graph just by doing linear algebra on these matrices or vector spaces that you extracted from the graph. And lastly, but not, certainly not least, is we're going to talk about computation. So there's going to be also this computational perspective, which is really, in a way, as a course which has its main home in the computer science department, it seems like this is where we should start and spend all our time. Hopefully we will get a fair amount of time to talk about it, but the relationship between graph problems, especially the kind of graph properties that we study from these different perspectives and their computational complexity, that is like how hard is it to actually compute them, is going to be something we spend the latter part of the class on. Okay, so these are all in some ways different perspectives on graph theory. Now, the perspectives all have formal mathematical structure. We're not just kind of like saying, oh, this is how I think about it. It is going to be different ways of thinking about graphs, but it's also going to be different ways of working with them formally and rigorously. And what we'll slowly work through and build up bit by bit is this idea that, in fact, these different perspectives are actually different categories. And when we change perspectives, we're changing categories. And we are not going to learn category theory, but we're going to know, at least see what a category is and see when we change between categories, what kinds of facts are still true. That is, what is still true about a graph, a drawing of a graph, compared to its, just say, combinatorial representation. Or if you take some vector space that you've extracted from the graph, what properties still hold for that vector space that are related to, say, the combinatorial properties of the original graph. All right, so this is kind of the overview. This is like the very high level view of what the whole course is going to be about. It should be fun, right? If it's not fun, then we're doing it wrong. And as I said, because graph theory is a really wide field, like there's so many different topics we can cover, my goal is not to just teach you graph theory, right? My goal is actually way more ambitious than this. I would like to not just teach you some facts about graph theory. I want to make you love it, right? I want you to love it so much that you embarrass people at cocktail parties by how much you want to talk about it. Now, that's a high goal. Maybe we won't get there. But there's certainly enough material and cool ideas in the class for us to have hopefully a lot of fun this semester.